Please join me in the call to worship. It's based on Psalms 146. I will praise the Lord as long as I live. I will sing praises to my God all my life long.
Do not put your trust in princes and mortals, in whom there is no help.
Happy are those who help it. It is any God of Jacob, whose hope is in the Lord their God.
The Lord sets the prisoners free. The Lord opens the eyes of the blind. The Lord lifts those who are bowed down. The Lord loves the righteous.
The Lord watches over the strangers. He upholds the orphan and the widow. But the way of the wicked leads to ruin.
I will praise the Lord as long as I live. I will sing praises to my God all my life long.
In this spirit, let us worship our God. Please stand if you are able and join me in singing hymn 687, Our God, Our Help in Ages Past.
With neighbors.
With humility, we ask forgiveness for believing the worst instead of seeing your face in each other. Forgive us when we are tempted to seek victory instead of seeking healing and justice. Open our eyes to the injustice of wealth and equity. Open our hearts to hard and necessary work to repair the breaches that divide us, to ensure that your mercy and justice is shared by all our brothers and sisters. Help us this day
and in the days ahead,
to move with humility, that our words may promote dignity and build your beloved community where all belong and all can flourish. In Christ's name, we pray.
Friends, by the water of our baptism, the Lord redeems the life of God's servants. None of those who take refuge in God will be turned away and put to shame. By the powerful cleansing waters of baptism, know that you are forgiven and know that you are free.
In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven and freed to new life. Thanks be to God.
Faithful God, how blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness. Sanctify us by your word and spirit so that we may glorify you in the company of the faithful, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Listen to the word that God has spoken. Listen to the one who is close at hand. Listen to the voice that began creation. Listen even if you don't understand.
For this morning is from Psalms 127, verses 1 to 2. Unless the Lord builds the house, those who build it labor in vain. Unless the Lord guards the city, the guard keeps watch in vain. It is vain that you rise up early and go late to rest, eating the bread of anxious toil, for he gives sleep to his beloved. Thanks be to God.
Amen.
Let us hear now the gospel of our Lord, coming to us through the words of Mark, chapter 12. As Jesus taught, he said, "Beware of the scribes, who like to walk about all day in long robes, and to be greeted with respect in the marketplaces, and to have the best seats in the synagogues and place of honor at the banquets. They devour widows' houses, and for the sake of appearance say long prayers. They will receive the greater condemnation." He sat down opposite the treasury and watched the crowd putting money into the treasury. Many rich people put in large sums. A poor widow came and put in two small copper coins, which are worth a penny. Then he called his disciples and said to them, "Truly, I tell you, this poor widow has put in more than all those who are contributing to the treasury. For all of them contributed out of their abundance, but she, out of her poverty, has put in everything she had, all she had to live on." The gospel of our Lord. First thoughts. A nation is judged by the way it cares for its people. We have a huge and very diverse population. Some might say too big to be effectively governed by any one leader or ideology. We also live in a democracy where votes are counted carefully after they are cast every 4 years to reflect the will of the people. We have principles of checks and balances for a reason, so no one ideology, party, or faction has complete control of the process. We have due process, which requires participation from the populace, but which must be governed by sober judgment and wise consideration of the fabric of the whole nation. That's the end of the political part of this speech. Everybody? We are together in this place, in this moment, however, to be reclaimed, rebalanced, and reminded that our ultimate citizenship is in the kingdom of God. Our opening hymn, written by Martin Luther over 500 years ago, twice the age of our nation, reminds us that God has always been our help and will continue to be our safe refuge from all the stormy blasts. We have heard the psalmist remind us that trying to build a house, that trying to build a life for a community without God's guidance will be full of folly and anxiety. Our gospel text from Mark reminds us that our Savior continues to prepare us and his disciples for his passion that is yet to come. If you recall in the past weeks that Takako and others have been guiding you, the disciples have had a hard time understanding that Jesus' message is not about who will be first or whose blindness is more debilitating. He's been counseling them continually to trust in God and to attend to the needs of the outcast, the most vulnerable, and to know that even the most powerless has the ear and the eye of our Lord as an advocate. This morning's passage from the 12th chapter will be Jesus' last public teaching before his road to the cross begins. And so I want to invite you all to take a few minutes to consider again the gospel from this morning, attending to where you find yourself in this story. Do you feel remorse as the scribes who walk about with pretense and self-importance, learned people blind to their own privilege? Do you resonate with Jesus's outrage and disgust for the scribes? Do you resonate with some in the crowds having their offerings, each trying to do their share? Do you feel pity for the widow, for her poverty, or outrage for her life experience that puts her in such a perilous position? Do you feel concern for her survival? Are you that widow? We cannot know for sure what all the motivations were present at this teaching, but we do not find a shred of pity or self-pity in the widow. She is empowered to make a choice and to act decisively, lavishly, generously. Perhaps Jesus identifies with her. preparing his disciples for his journey to put in everything he had for the glory of God. We know that there is no hiding from God. We know that God sees through pretense and sees the longings and intentions of our hearts. God is always redeeming us and renewing us for the work of the day. God sees us, sees our intentions, our actions, and accepts us, even when our efforts may be overlooked by others. It is a powerful lesson for us to hear today as the beloved community in a fractured world. What are we, as the body of Christ, called to do in this time? To create patient, safe space to hear different points of view and to hear underneath them the human longing? Is it our calling to work with determination for mutual care for the poor and outcast? Is it our challenge to challenge unjust systems of oppression? Is it our calling to pray soberly for direction and self-examination of what our work is to do? Is it our joyful calling to prepare for Christ's reconciliation of the world, which is why he came? Maybe it's a combination, or maybe it's something else. What we do know as human beings is that there are times when it all gets to be too much. And when it all seems too much, dogs and children are insistent, intuitive reminders of the need to get outside, to get out in nature, and to clear our minds. Staying inside and pacing or watching endless newsreels leads to squirrely behavior. Movement helps rebalance our minds, gets our blood flowing, opens up our lungs, loosens our aching muscles, and restores balance to our perspective. It is also important to watch where you step so you don't plummet down a ravine or turn your ankle or step in something disgusting. I want to close this time with a story from 27 years ago when I was brand new to New Mexico, invited by friends for a hike in your backyard near Battleship Rock. My husband and I, along with our ebullient 18-month-old redheaded daughter, were eager to explore our new home. So off we went, tromping up a dirt trail which wound back and forth through beautiful canyon. I believe we crossed the stream at least 7 times, with the guys portaging giggling Clarissa back and forth each time. It was about 90 minutes into the hike that our friends let us know that this was their first time hiking in this place, and they didn't have a map. Remember, 27 years ago was long before Google Maps were even a thing. So we laughed and kept going. Then it started to rain, and we lost the trail. And then it rained harder. And we found ourselves on hands and knees, scrambling up slippery foliage. We referred to this as the Cambodia part of the hike. We passed a cow skull, which we knew was emblematic of New Mexico, but it wasn't particularly comforting. We heard a coyote howl, and the daylight began to wane, and our courage started to get shaky. And then, in the distance, the sound of an engine. "Yay!" announced Clarissa. "A car!" We were saved. There are some learnings from that hike so long ago that I think perhaps are applicable to us today as we find our road ahead. Go with a guide, preferably one who knows the way. Prepare for adventure. Bring water. Bring a can-do attitude. Keep your eye on the trail. Travel together. Keep watching for the landmarks. Help each other over the rough spots. Above all, keep going and praise God for the journey that we have together. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
scripture teaches us, freely you have received, freely give. Let us return to God the offerings of our life and the gifts of the earth.
Inner turmoil that robbed me of my sleep only a few weeks ago has now become a strange emotion of the past. Books that filled with amazement a few days ago do not seem as important. Thoughts that kept my mind captive only a few hours ago have lost their power and have been replaced by others? Why am I continuously trapped in the sense of urgency and emergency? Why do I not see that you are eternal, that your kingdom lasts forever, and that for you 1,000 years are like one day? O Lord, let me enter into your presence and there taste the eternal, timeless, everlasting love with which you invited me to let go of the time-bound anxieties, fears, preoccupations, and worries. Lord, teach me your ways and give me the courage to follow them. I invite your petitions as you are able and willing to give them. Glenn.
Yes, I pray for an end to the wars in the Middle East. I pray for my son, Houston, who's leading Palestine now in the peace delegation, hoping to get on a plane when airlines are canceling in the Middle East, leaving Friday this week, so safety for Houston and others.
Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Yes.
Traveling mercies for our granddaughter June and her partner who are coming to visit us this week.
Traveling mercies.
Lord, hear our prayers.
Lord, hear our prayers.
Lord, hear our prayers of thanksgiving.
Lord, hear our prayers. I would say thanksgiving for the snow, even though it's been uncomfortable. We live in the desert and we need it. And now we have a week of sun, so to the Creator, thanks.
To the Creator. Lord, hear our prayers.
One from Zoomland, where Tom and Suzanne are thanking us for our healing wishes and prayers, and they are mending. Thanks be to God.
Lord, hear our prayers. Yes.
Maybe we should be thankful and offer a prayer for the remnant of the church in Cuba who would faithfully hanging on there.
Yes.
And even as the declines for them, so for Cuba Church, they can do with their time.
Quakers too, though.
Lord, hear our prayers.
And for the people of the island of Cuba who are going through their own extreme turmoil, but we understand are taking in new members to their church even in the midst of hurricanes and horrible conditions. So for all people worshiping in Cuba, wherever that is, Lord,
hear our prayers.
I would invite you now to take the litany for Election Day. And let us read it responsibly as we conclude our spoken prayers today. Great God of power and sovereignty, wonderful counselor of governance and order, Spirit God, who forms and reforms and creates and recreates your people, your church, and your world. In your all-inclusive embrace, we rest more serenely, and we pray that we and our leaders may learn from your example of servant leadership.
Enable us to ponder old texts of scripture, to apply them to our present circumstances, reshaping our hearts according to what you have heard of us, and bringing peace and unity to our nation, to guide and lead our minds.
Although we may have our heads turned by votes and elections and winners and power and leverage, give us enough compassion to value traditions other than our own. Give us enough mercy to entertain and engage with cultures with which we may be unfamiliar. And give us enough humility to ask for forgiveness for old sins of prejudice or partisanship.
In this world, O God, lead us to put our trust in the power of good to overcome evil, and the power of love to overcome hatred. Bless us with provision to see the world emancipated from violence, and the faith to fashion a new reality, where fear will no longer be anyone to commit injustice.
At this time in our country's history, send your spirit of grace to reside with us and to attend to us in our anxiety, forgiving us in our small-mindedness, engaging us in your life-giving work, and equipping us to turn the weapons of our words to your message of mercy.
Call us upon ourselves, O Lord, so that our witness to share the ever waves of grain to grain would prevail over any fear the early night of our night for causes
during this intense time, infuse us with the patience to listen well, with the wisdom to discern effectively, and with the dignity that guards us from prejudice and partisanship.
Where the torn fabric of our common life is torn, bind us together with the brethren of your love. Turn us away from our tendency to self-destructive and infuse us with the vision for the neighborhood.
Amid our competing loyalties and ideologies, give us the courage to live out our baptismal callings as your people, so that we may commit ourselves afresh to the common good, to the sharing of resources, and to the welcoming of the other, employing this place on our planet as a visible venue for your way in the world.
And fortitude to fulfill the expectations you have for us, so that we may use our gifts to serve your large purposes for the world. For we ask all these things in the name of Jesus Christ, who taught his disciples to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Forgive us and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Let us stand as we are able and sing together the closing hymn, number 697, Take My Life.
Oh,
take my love, my Lord, I pray.
Thank you.
Yes.